This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. Then suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak, for she had said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned, and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, "Go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout that district. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. I think most of us have probably been around long enough to know that life is uncertain. Unexpected things come to us in ways that we may not have anticipated. Things that we may not have imagined in the past being important to us become central. And things that once we held to be very important become something we barely even think about. Life is uncertain. We don't know what's coming. And sometimes life brings us good things. And sometimes life brings us bad things. And these aren't part of some plan to make us suffer or to lift us up only to cut us down. That we are given free will and things in life just sort of come to us. But in order to learn to sort of deal with the uncertainty of life, the unfairness of life, God has given us promises. He's promised us that what happens to us in this life is not the final word on our existence. He promises us that those who we know and who we love and who we lose are not lost forever, but in some way that can be reattained. And he promises us that when we feel most afraid and most alone, that God is with us to give us courage and to show us that we can do things that we never thought we could possibly do. And in order for us to partake of these promises, God has given us this great gift of faith. And faith, as St. Paul tells us, is the expectation of things hoped for. Right? And that order to hold on to the promises that God gives us, he's given us this gift of faith. And of course, the gift of the Holy Spirit to bolster our faiths. And faith is a thing that once given can never be taken back. You can lose it, but it will never be taken from you. It cannot be stolen. But it can be strengthened. It can be made more powerful. It can be made more clear and more resolute in our lives. And when we partake of the disciplines of faith, you know, of worship and prayer and service and study and generosity and Sabbath, that our faith becomes stronger. And we're more able to hold on to the promises that God gives us to carry us through the things that life brings us. We have been given this great gift of faith. And in this story today, in the Gospels, the question comes to us, who are God's promises for? Who is worthy of the gift of faith? Because in the before times, you know, before Jesus, literally BC, There is an idea that faith was not a gift that was given freely, but something that was very carefully distributed. And that the way to achieve God's promises were to follow closely these temple rituals and to partake in the sacrifices and to follow the law obediently, not really concerning yourself very much about where it ran into the fuzziness of life. And there was a very strong idea that the people to whom good things happened were loved by God, and the people to whom bad things happened were rejected by God. And there are still lots of people today who think that way. There are lots of gatekeepers who believe that it's their job to ensure that the gifts of God are held close, like some sort of secret buried treasure that's not meant to be shared. There's a great meme I've seen lately that if God didn't send Jesus into the world to condemn it, I doubt that he sent you. And it's true that God loves the world. God, it's a creation. We hear when he created all that there is, looked at it and said that it was good. And he's given us this wonderful creation in which to live and to provide for all of the things that we need. And so we've been given these gifts. And so Jesus is confronting this question of who are the gifts for? And in this story, he meets three people. He meets a tax collector. He meets a woman who has been suffering from an illness. And he meets a child who maybe has died. At least everybody thinks she has died. And what Jesus says is the promises are also for you. Because each of those people were understood to be outside of the promise. That a tax collector was a traitor to his people and someone who had forsworn what it meant to be a member of Israel, to be one of God's people, someone who oppressed and took advantage of others, someone who stood outside of the law. And a woman who is suffering, we know, I don't recall if it says in this scripture, we know from other scriptures that she's suffering from hemorrhages, so she's been bleeding. And of course, blood is impure, and so if you are constantly bleeding, you are also outside of the law. You're outside of the promises. They aren't for you. And of course, the family that's mourning, they understand the death of their child as a punishment in some way. And I know it feels that way, but I don't think it's God's punishment. So each of these feel themselves or are understood to be outside of the law and outside of the promise. But each of these three people is one of the people mentioned in the Sermon on the Mount. And this story is happening right after the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus gives the Sermon on the Mount, and he begins with the Beatitudes, and he goes on to talk about all of the ways that God's promises are present and available to people. And then he leaves the Sermon on the Mount, and he begins walking around, and that's when this story takes place. And so we find a man who is spiritually poor, a tax collector. And we find a woman who is meek, and she's afraid that she can't even talk to Jesus. She just hopes that she can get close enough to touch the fringes of his cloak. And of course, we find a family that's mourning. And then these are the people that Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount has told us are blessed. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And that these people are the Beatitudes come to life. That Jesus is showing us that the gift of faith is not something that is held close or tight. And it's not something for people who are perfect or who never ever break a rule. That the promises of God are for everybody, and that the blessing that Jesus talks about in the Attitudes is not about it's wonderful to be poor or meek or mourning. That even when we are in a place where we feel ourselves outside of the promise, we are not. In fact, what Jesus tells us is that God is most present to us, most aware of us, most concerned about us in exactly those moments. When we feel the darkness, it's when the light of God shines brightest. And that's the promise that we are given. And it is the faith of the church that we have all taken on, and that I hope that we all work to grow and strengthen, that allows us to see that light in the darkness, that allows us to transform the worst things that happen to us in something different, something hopeful. That Jesus shows us in his life and his teachings and in this very story that the blessings of God are not reserved and they're not carefully meted out, but that God shares God's love recklessly, and most especially when we feel as though we are unloved, God loves us even more. Amen.